These are 3D printed self-folding origami called Thermorph. The flat part is printed using a special method on a regular 3D printer, and once you put it into warm water, it quickly morphs and folds into a pre-programmed shape. In this video, we'll examine the ingenious method used to make them and real-world applications of morphing techniques. Let's find out more. Guten Tag, everybody. I'm Stefan, and welcome to CNC Kitchen. This video is brought to you by KiwiCo. Click the link in the description and get a great discount on your first month of KiwiCo. The incredible method I present here is called Thermorph, developed by the authors of a paper I discovered more than 5 years ago, and I have wanted to try this myself ever since. Not only does it look truly mesmerizing when the flat sheets morph into a three-dimensional shape, but this method also shows how 3D printing and tuning 3D printing parameters can be utilized to program the final shape of a material. The name itself describes the method, where a property of a thermoplastic polymer enables morphing behavior. Thus we have thermorph, thermoplastic morph, or even thermal morphing. The mechanism by which these flat sheets begin to deform is somewhat similar to the bimetallic effect you might be very familiar with. A bimetal strip consists out of two different metals with dissimilar thermal expansion coefficients. When heated, one expands more than the other, causing it to bend. So, how do we achieve the similar expansion or contraction with a plastic 3D printed part? Here we leverage a property that is often seen as a defect in 3D printing. If you own a 3D printer, you know the frustration of printing a part only for it to lift off the building plate at a corner after a few layers, completely ruining the part. The reason for this warping are the internal stresses generated by the layer-by-layer process. When molten filament is quickly pushed through a small nozzle, the polymer chains are squished and stretched, causing significant internal stresses, almost like a rubber band that's being stretched. If you don't give them enough time to realign, these internal stresses will stay within the part. This can be nicely demonstrated by taking several strips of electrical tape, pre-stretching them, and then stacking them on top of each other. Each layer pulls on the already existing one until the adhesive on the first layer can no longer hold, causing everything to curl up. If a 3D printed part sticks to the plate and everything cools down quickly, these internal stresses become baked into the part. Now, let's discuss how these internal stresses can be used for shape changing. If you are into 3D printing and have tried to anneal a PLA part for better thermal resistance, you know what often happens when you heat your part above its glass transition temperature TG. They significantly deform. The stiffness of a polymer doesn't change linearly with temperature, instead it shows a sharp transition known as the glass transition temperature, where the material shifts from a glassy solid to a rubbery yet still not molten consistency. At this point we allow the polymer chains to move slightly again as they try to release the stresses that were baked into the part during printing and cooldown. Since these chains were aligned and pre-stretched in the printing direction, they typically begin to contract in this direction as well, causing our part to shorten. Typically, the direction of the infill changes from layer to layer, causing the part to shrink both in the X and the Y axis. If we use aligned rectilinear infill, the printing direction remains consistent, allowing us to control the direction of contraction effectively. This test part right here primarily shrunk in the printing direction and barely had a size change perpendicular to it. This is one of the phenomena utilized to make our Thermorphs part work. However, currently, they only contract and do not truly bend. When we consider the bimetallic effect, we find two layers that contract differently, causing the strip to bend. To achieve something similar with our 3D printed part, the authors of the paper suggest a sandwich structure that uses PLA as the active layer and TPU as the constrained layer, both forming a so-called actuator. If we print a layer of TPU on top of three layers of PLA and heat it up again, we can clearly observe how the sheet bends towards the PLA side. The PLA contracts when heated, but the TPU layer constrains that contraction on one side, causing the entire structure to bend. Once we remove it from the water, it will solidify in its morphed shape. By combining printing direction and layer stackup, we can customize how the part will deform. If our printing direction is along the strip, it simply folds up. If we print at a 45 degree angle, the part will twist. If we alternate the stackup and create sections where the active layer is on the top and others where it is on the bottom, we can design a part that resembles a snake. Of course, we can make it even more complex. In this way, by adjusting the layer stack up and printing orientation, we can basically program the final morph shape into our flat 3D printed part. And that's the reason why we can call this method even 4D printing. This effect is also reversible. Unlike our bimetallic example, where the deformation disappears when the material cools, the deformed shape of our thermorph part remains locked in once cooled. However, if we place the morphed part back into warm water and heat it above its glass transition temperature again, it softens, allowing us to stretch it back into its original flat shape. Once cooled, it again maintains this new configuration. When we reheat it, it will morph back into its programmed shape, and we can do that over and over again. We can not only reset the deformation into its flat state, but also completely crumple it up while it's soft and let it cool down. Regardless of how we deform it, reheating will always return it to the shape defined during printing. This behavior is known as the shape memory effect, a phenomenon found not only in metals, but also in polymers. Shape memory is a fascinating property of certain materials that allows them to remember and revert to a predefined shape after being deformed. While only certain metal alloys exhibit this shape memory property, it is quite common in polymers, with the most popular 3D printing material, PLA, demonstrating it as well. When a shape memory polymer is heated above its glass transition temperature TG, its internal structure becomes flexible, enabling reshaping. Once cooled, this new shape is temporarily fixed. However, when reheated, the polymer's molecular chains realign, returning to its morphed low-energy form. Thermorphs leverage this property to create programmable 3D printed objects that shape change when heated, opening up exciting possibilities for smart materials and responsive designs. Before we analyze how we can precisely control the final shape of our thermorphs, let me quickly tell you about today's video sponsor, KiwiCo. Every month, KiwiCo delivers a crate full of exciting STEM projects right to your door. Projects that inspire kids to explore, build, and create. They have different clubs for every age and interest, starting all the way from newborns up to teenagers, and adults like me still get a kick out of it too. We recently received our first panda crate for our newborn, and she absolutely loved the tummy time activities. It's perfect for helping her discover the world around her with high quality toys, and it's super memorable for us to see her learn new things every day through all the well-curated activities. The clever thing is that KiwiCo grows with your children, and you'll always receive new projects based on their age. Our older daughter is now part of the KiwiCo Sprout Club, which focuses on hands-on projects that spark her creativity. This month's theme was a camping adventure. She built a tent, had a blast setting up her fireplace, and learned how to make her first pretend s'mores. It's always great to see how much joy she has in building the project and exploring new topics and concepts. The materials are high quality, actually often wood, with clear instructions and everything included to finish a project. There's also a magazine in every box that dives deeper into the science or art behind the topic, which we always love flipping through when finishing building. If you want to see the same joy and spark in your own kids and support my channel, head to kiwico.com/cnc and use code CNC on checkout. You'll get 50% off your first month if you're joining a club for kids 3 and up, or 20% off your first panda crate if you also have a little one at home. That's kiwico.com/cnc. It's a fantastic way to help kids develop new skills, feed their curiosity, and spend a little less time in front of a screen. A big thanks to KiwiCo for sponsoring this video. Okay, back to the thermorphs. To achieve the desired shape of the first parts that we printed, we primarily controlled the layer stack up to determine whether we were producing concave or convex parts. The printing angle dictated the direction of the bend. However, this process felt somewhat random and lacked precise control. To make this method applicable for more complex shapes, we need to enhance our understanding and control over the bend angle and radius. This is where the beauty of additive manufacturing comes into play. When printing a part, we can adjust numerous parameters that influence not only the appearance of our print, but also its properties. This aspect highlights the novelty of the work presented in this paper. The amount of bending primarily depends on the internal stresses present in our 3D printed part. The primary way to control these internal stresses is by varying the printing speed. The faster we print, the more violently the polymer chains get stretched, and the less time they have to relax again, leading to higher residual stresses in the part. To demonstrate this, I printed sample strips with the actuator part in the middle, made at varying speeds from 20 to 160 millimeters a second. Once they were finished printing, I placed them into 75 degrees Celsius water for 2 minutes to activate the actuator. I then carefully removed them from the water and allowed them to fully solidify again. When we place them side by side, we can clearly see that the bending angle is the smallest at low speeds and gradually increases with faster speeds. This is already one parameter that we can use to program specific angles into a Thermorph 3D print. Another significant parameter affecting the folding angle is the actuator length. Each section of an actuator contributes to the bend. Therefore, if we place several sections side by side, so simply make it longer, the total bending angle will increase. To illustrate this, I printed samples with different actuator lengths ranging from 5 to 40 millimeters and activated them in hot water. Once removed, we can see our hypothesis confirmed, and the range of adjustment is quite significant. Since both printing speed and actuator length impact the achieved angle, we would need to test all combinations and measure the bend angle and bend radius to get a complete picture. If we were to design a thermorph and needed a specific bend angle, we could use a lookup table to determine the appropriate printing speed and actuator length. Still, this would be really tedious, and designing a thermorph from scratch is quite involved. That's the reason why the research behind Thermorph created a software tool to streamline the design process. It allows for two design methods, inverse design and forward design. In inverse design, you start with a 3D model of the shape that you desire, like the Stanford bunny for example. The software first simplifies the model to reduce the number of faces. It then calculates how to unfold the shape into a flat printable pattern while determining where to place the bending actuators so it can fold back into the original shape when heated. This is incredibly useful if you have a specific 3D printed object designed and want to transform it into a self-assembling structure without manually figuring out the folding procedure. Then there's forward design, which operates in the opposite direction. Instead of beginning with a 3D model, you import a 2D drawing that includes the outlines of your part and the folding locations. The software then allows you to specify specific bending angles at the hinge points. You can modify these angles, simulate the folding process, and refine the appearance of the final shape. This approach is excellent if you want to have greater creative control over the morphing behavior, and it strongly reminds me of real origami. If you're interested in detailed information on how these processes function, I highly recommend checking the paper itself. Regardless of whether you're using the forward or the inverse design approach, you need G-code to provide the 3D printer instructions to print the part. The Thermorph software takes the unfolded flat shape, assigns specific printing parameters for each region, determined from the speed and length experiments, and creates the print file that can be used on a regular 3D printer capable of working with two different materials. Unfortunately, I didn't have access to the software, so I had to do all the design steps manually. I started in Onshape, my favorite browser-based CAD tool. For simple shapes, I sketched them out, ensuring I established boundaries where I later wanted and needed to apply different parameters. For more complex shapes, you can also use the sheet metal tool within Onshape. I extruded the various sections 0.2 millimeters thick, which is the layer height I used for all of my prints. Then I applied a linear pattern to create the four individual layers that all my prints would have. To simplify assigning the different parameters, I used Boolean operations to merge all the sections that would receive the same settings. For an actuator, I merged the three active PLA layers, so I only have one part for the TPU constraint and one part for the active portion. Then I exported the whole assembly as one STL and opened it in Orca slicer. The first step was to split the single STL into individual parts again to apply different parameters. First, I assigned the materials to the individual components. Most are usually PLA, while the constraint layers are assigned to the TPU profile. Then it became a Sisyphean task to assign all the appropriate printing speeds and infill orientations to all of the remaining actuator sections, resulting in a finished sliced file where we can observe all the individual settings we applied at work. You might have noticed that I used Hilbert curve infill for the sections that I want to keep flat, because of the numerous short print moves in every direction, which also lead to a relatively low speed, this type of infill generates only minimal internal stresses. If you print flat plates with standard rectilinear infill, they will still warp or significantly shrink during heat activation, which can disrupt our model. The flat areas printed with Hilbert curve infill shrink only slightly and also do not warp, making this infill great for passive flat sections. As far as I understood it, the authors of the paper used simply four layers of TPU for the flat sections, which I found too floppy, so I consider my method a contribution to the Thermorph technique. I intentionally didn't go into full details here because that might bore the most of you. If you're interested in a complete walkthrough from the design in Onshape to the Orca slicer setup, let me know in the comments and I'll post a separate video on it. I also uploaded a bunch of my models on printables for you to download and explore. My parts were printed on the Prusa XL onto blue tape that I slightly sanded so I wouldn't need a heated bed. This is very important because our printed material needs to cool down quickly below the glass transition temperature. On a heated bed, your first layers are always above TG, which would release stresses and ruin our actuator's performance. I used white dust filament PLA for the active part, which is a very non-modified PLA. PLA plus filaments sometimes don't build up as much internal stresses, which would be detrimental to our actuator. Initially, I used extruder TPU, but encountered problems because that TPU didn't adhere to my PLA properly. I tried several other brands and ended up with Fibology 4DD TPU. This combination allowed me to reliably print the parts for this video. Unfortunately, I didn't achieve as beautiful results on some of the parts like the flower model as the authors of the paper, but I've only been experimenting with this method for 2 weeks, not years, so there's still plenty of potential improvement. Also, the pyramid I tried to make in the example was quite a failure, but also shows that maybe additional parameters like gravity might be a significant factor for larger structures. You might be wondering what the benefits of this technology are, aside from the mesmerizing appearance as the flat sheet transforms into a three-dimensional structure. The authors of the paper note that their innovative approach, which programs the shape using speed variation and readily available materials like PLA and TPU, provides easy access for everyone interested in further researching or applying this technology to real-world problems. Thermorphs can significantly reduce printing and rework time because they don't require any support, yet later fold into complex three-dimensional structures. Additionally, there are virtually no layer lines, which make the parts exceptionally strong. They envision applications for boats, shelters or large-scale furniture that are flat and easy to transport after printing, but automatically fold into usable structures when heated, potentially even just by sunlight.
Real-world applications of self-folding structures aren't actually too far-fetched, and there's a massive building in my city that has been built with a very similar technique.
This is Wangen Tower, a unique wooden lookout tower built just a year ago for a huge garden expo held here. Just like our Thermorph structures that deform under the internal stresses induced during 3D printing, the large and thick plates used to construct this tower were also shaped using a morphing technique. But instead of activating the deformation by temperature, these wooden panels were morphed after gluing them together while they were still wet and then drying them out. Wood shrinks differently during drying depending on its fiber orientation. By stacking the wood sheets in different orientations, they were able to create impressive three-dimensional structures without needing large presses or extensive machining. Once the panels were dry, a locking lamination was applied to prevent them from unwarping due to changes in humidity. I'm really grateful to have such an impressive structure right where I live that employs very similar morphing techniques we also explored in this video. If you're ever in southern Germany, be sure to check out this tower as well as our city. So there you have it. I hope I was able to give you a brief introduction to self-folding structures and how we can cleverly program them using 3D printing. I'd love to hear your thoughts on this technique in the comments. If you want to do your own research, make sure to check out the links in the description, where you can also find some of the sample files I printed here in the studio. Thanks for watching, everyone. I hope you found this video interesting. If you want to support my work, head over to Patreon or become a YouTube member. Also, check out the other videos in my library. I hope to see you in the next one. Auf Wiedersehen and goodbye. This month's theme.